This video is sponsored by HelloFresh. HelloFresh makes cooking at home fun, easy, and affordable. Get mouthwatering seasonal recipes and fresh, pre-measured ingredients delivered right to your door with HelloFresh, America's number one meal kit. I couldn't be happier that HelloFresh is sponsoring this video because it really is my favorite meal kit service, and believe me, I've tried them all. And why are they my favorite? Well, for one simple reason, because their recipes are so delicious. I recently chose the Creamy Dreamy Mushroom Cavatappi as part of my delivery, and not only is it insanely good, but it was truly a dream to cook. The step-by-step recipe and pre-portioned ingredients make everything come together in no time, and when I finally tasted it, I could hardly believe how good it was. It was honestly better than most restaurant pasta dishes I've had, and it was cheaper than one too. HelloFresh meals are on average 72% cheaper than dining at a restaurant, according to a Zagat Dining Survey. And not only are you saving money with HelloFresh, but you're saving the environment too. HelloFresh is the first carbon-neutral meal kit company, and nearly all the packaging is recyclable. So what are you waiting for? Use my link or go to HelloFresh.com and use code POGINFOGRAPH16 for up to 16 free meals plus 3 surprise gifts across 6 HelloFresh boxes plus free shipping. From working in your sleep to living in giant technological prisons, to the elites swanning off to another planet while you slog it out like a slave down here, the future is fantastically frightening. Hold on tight and get ready for a population explosion the likes of which the world has never seen. 10 billion. When a well-known demographer was asked about population growth recently, he came up with a quite frightening answer. That was, every billion more people makes life more difficult for everybody. It's as simple as that. Well, that doesn't really bode well for the people that are going to star in our trip to the future. Still, he said at 10 billion, we'll do just fine. We'll get by adding that it is literally not the end of the world. In the 1960s, some experts were expecting a growth bomb which would result in mass starvation in places like India. They said we need to prepare for poverty like we've never seen before. Still, go back to the year 1866 and some so-called experts in the UK said England's growth was totally unsustainable because of the country's dwindling coal reserves. So with that in mind, when it comes to getting it right, people we often look up to get it wrong. It's so hard to call. When in 1960 Time magazine wrote about the population explosion, the population was 3 billion. It had taken just 33 years to go from 2 to 3 billion, but it had taken 125 years to go from 1 to 2 billion. In 1968, people were getting pretty scared, with a book called The Population Bomb saying we have to resort to either population control or a race to oblivion. And that's why some scientists say when making such predictions, we should do so with caution, because things can change. We've seen the growth rate decline in recent history, but for the sake of today's show, for reasons we'll talk about, we're just going to pretend that this isn't a factor. We're forecast to hit 10 billion in 2050, so we predict the world won't look all that different at that milestone. It won't mean we're suddenly thrust into some kind of dystopian sci-fi movie. That's what the experts say, anyway. Nonetheless, Stephen Immett, hailed as one of London's most influential scientists and author of the book 10 Billion, once said, "Every which way you look at it, a planet of 10 billion looks like a nightmare." Still, for his nightmare to come to fruition, we think that we should look at what happens at 20 billion, because some people think this guy was way too pessimistic. 20 billion. When it comes to a big rise in the number of humans on the planet, Immett summed it up in a not very scientific way, simply stating, "I think we are bleeped." He's right, because in our world, when we hit 20 billion, we hadn't changed much in our ways, and we didn't have any super technology to drastically change how we live. We're facing what someone had once predicted, an unprecedented planetary emergency. Nonetheless, at this point, we're still stuffing our faces with little regard to what we are eating or how it's made. We are happily consuming energy without considering how the energy sources were being depleted, and how making that energy is creating a warmer world. Half the world is turning into one giant dustbin, and the other half was turned into a polluted wasteland. However, the rich that control the technology that we're totally immersed in have separated from us. They're beginning to move into the least polluted parts of the world. This great separation will soon become the standard. We'll get to a point where we just accept that some people have to suffer and other lives have to be sustained in comfort for what they say is the greater good of mankind. Obviously, there are riots of all kinds and anti-government sentiment, but since every waking movement we made was tracked and traced and our lives depended on how we fared in global point systems, it was hard to rebel. Even buying food depended on how many points we had and what good citizen score we had. Just as the writer George Orwell feared when he wrote the book 1984, Big Brother watched over us all, and the world was going to hell in a handbasket. There wasn't much we could do about it. And as natural resources dwindled and places became more polluted, the powers that be were compelled to design a new kind of infrastructure for us plebs. 30 billion. Many years before, when the population was just under 8 billion, lots of people talked about a green revolution. That never happened. As poorer countries got richer, most people in those countries wanted to see what living life as a conspicuous consumer felt like. That hardly melded very well with the green movement, and you can be sure that those rich Europeans and Americans didn't want to sacrifice anything in their three-car families. 30 billion people meant a lot more three-car families, and that meant more growth. But it wasn't sustainable. These people in the former developing world had watched many people in the West living without a care in the world for years. Watching them physically fight each other in stores over video games, their massive backsides and protruding bellies crashing into each other like slow-moving icebergs made out of lard. Now, most of the world's poor, which was around 85% of the global population, had what they wanted, but something drastic had to happen to keep those people from devouring the planet. A long time ago, a man had introduced the world to the metaverse, which he said would transform people's lives, stating that it would increase happiness and well-being. But in his brave new world, technology only ended up as a kind of drug that offered a new form of slave labor and distraction from all the wrongs in society. These sleepwalkers in the metaverse lived in tiny rooms in newly constructed apartment complexes that spanned for miles and miles. Tens of thousands of people lived in each complex, buildings that were given the name Panopticons, because everything people did in there was recorded. It prevented much crime from happening, but these buildings were real horror shows to live in. Experts in the past had talked about the sixth mass extinction, but because that had never happened, the people didn't believe in other scary predictions. They lost all trust in so-called experts. And anyway, once in the metaverse, they'd forgotten about extinction. The food problem, though, was very real, as the extinction of many species of insects had occurred, leading to massive loss of ecosystems with their life-sustaining plants and animals. That didn't matter, because food had been taken care of. Now, as people ran around their metaverse scoring points, they were delivered nutrients through intravenous drips connected to huge containers in every panopticon. The lab-made liquid nutrients were enough to sustain life, barely. Ironically, this great invention was called fast food, a type of cuisine back in the day that was said to be bad for your health. Now, the only people who ate food from animals and real plants were the very rich. The vast majority of people had only ever seen something like a cow or a blueberry in a virtual form. They fished, but only in the metaverse when they were farming and fishing for the elite in the depleted oceans. But even with all this misery, the population kept on growing at an astonishing rate. 40 billion. It took several years for the population to increase from 30 billion to 40 billion. Inside those panopticons, there was one other thing to do outside of the metaverse. People humped like rabbits, and the government, now a world government speaking in only one language, actually endorsed this. By the way, the world government knew that getting everyone to speak one language was important. Control the language and you control the people. Gradually, everyone only spoke English. In the metaverse, just like in the old real world, the main focus in a global sense was economic growth. Now that that world, the virtual world, was endless, there could be infinite growth. Humans were like hamsters on wheels, and the more they virtually ran, the more virtual profits they created for the owners of the technology, now unironically called titans. Such a word came from ancient Greek mythology, though no worker would have known that because books hadn't been read for years. Books weren't banned, but the human mind had slowly evolved to not be able to tolerate any kind of composed concentration outside of hitting the correct buttons. They could even do that in their sleep, since the new hibernation pods had made it possible to perform simple tasks while part of the mind was getting some winks. This meant that they could work around the clock, which was required to keep the virtual and real infrastructure running. When they weren't working, they were playing and conversing in the metaverse, again, for more points. The more virtual friendships you had, the more points you got, so not many people wasted time trying to meet real folks in real life. That was time-consuming, and it didn't always work out. In terms of hand-eye coordination, humans became at least 50 times faster compared to humans back when the metaverse began, but hardly anyone could finish a sentence without feeling confused and nauseous. It didn't matter. People put up with their tepid distractions because they didn't know any other reality. Happiness could only really be understood through points. People were told when they were happy and they believed it. And at least they had sex, unemotional sex, which is why the population kept increasing at an astonishing rate of around 8 billion a year. 50 billion. Artificial intelligence had never become conscious, despite what people said years ago. But when the population hit 50 billion, it was advanced enough to know what people needed before they knew it. No one ever felt hungry, because the receptors in the brain that sent messages to the stomach were intercepted before any real cognition happened. Fast food was delivered without any interruption of thought, which gave folks much more time to work. Oil never ran out. There was an endless amount of it, enough to keep technology going in the Panopticon full of life, or half-life as the Titans called it. The refineries, factories, and plants were all running using AI along with the human workers who never had to leave their tiny rooms. Working from home many, many years earlier had been sold as something progressive, but as things turned out, it only meant less physical interactions with others and much more work. It wasn't illegal to be unemployed, of course, but fewer points meant fewer doors could be opened in the metaverse. Essentially, that also meant less sex. The unemployed were like the lepers of the Middle Ages, wandering around the rundown parts of the metaverse with their virtual faces hidden. But for the elites who only ever entered the metaverse to have a laugh or contemplate the creation of new worlds, something was changing. 60 billion. After pollution became so bad that much of the world's flora and fauna was disappearing, the elites moved into city-like containments of their own. These were vast sections of the world that had once been countryside. They got the name Moreveres after Thomas More, the man who'd written a 15th century book called Utopia. These highly regulated environments were safe, unpolluted, and contained just about all of the valuable artifacts that had ever existed in the old world. Thanks to gene manipulation, most rich people could expect to live a healthy life. Life expectancy for the elites was now around 150 years, a maximum that had been predicted many years ago. Humans could prevent disease, but there was nothing they could do about blood pressure, blood cell counts, or other bodily things related to natural aging. Cancer and many viruses were a thing of the past for the elites, but for the workers of the metaverse, they very much existed. In fact, for them, life expectancy was only around 60, even though medicine was greatly improved by this point. According to Dr. Mustafa Marx, who'd made breakthroughs in human psychology, the workers' decreased will to live in such a virtual world resulted in fewer years lived on average. "The mind is the master of longevity," Marx once said at a conference for metaverse engineers. Marx had invented neural implants which were supposed to stop this from happening, but happiness and sadness were tough nuts to crack. No amount of technology could make humans happier. Humans had never managed to decode the brain because the brain, and more importantly consciousness, had remained for the most part a mystery. This is why the super elites, who now all lived in one single containment city high on a hill that they named Olympus, had over the years a reinvigorated interest when it came to what had once been scorned by science. That was a belief in the soul. The soul was back in fashion for the supers. It didn't matter how many bionic prosthetics they had to improve their natural bodies, their souls could still be plagued by unwanted feelings. They had bigger concerns anyway. That sixth extinction was looking more and more likely. 70 billion. Even though the containment cities were safe from most of the vagaries of the environment, and even though the people in the Panopticons were mostly safe from rising temperatures and toxic pollution, some more pessimistic scientists believed that things were going to go from bad to worse. They said that the humans had to live off Earth. The end of the world was nigh. Real money had not existed in the world for some time. The workers had only need for points, and the elites lived in collective luxury. As the proud designers of the metaverse and the containments, they lived in utter comfort. But that didn't mean everyone got to leave the planet. Getting to Mars in numbers had ceased being a problem in the late 21st century, a bit later than expected. It wasn't just because the technologists had exaggerated the engineering capacity, but the will wasn't there to leave Earth back then. It turned out that when people were finally able to live up there, despite the problems on Earth, they didn't want to go. At the start, colonizing Mars was also very dangerous due to the radiation exposure people faced. It took years to fill the first permanent settlement there, which only became possible after a water source had been found during years of underground exploration. Even when people could stay on Mars, the microgravity and toxicity of the place seriously affected their health after a few years. It turned out that even with spacesuits and containment, you got sick. In short, living on Mars was like living in prison, especially when dust storms shrouded the settlement in darkness for long periods of time. But as Earth's population kept on expanding and the conditions for life on Earth were worsening, Mars was looking like a suitable alternative for super elites. As for the vast majority of others down on Earth, it was out of the question that they'd ever see a takeoff. When the elites went, they would do so in secret. 80 billion. Improved drilling methods on Mars led to more water sources being discovered. The drilling teams were now run from Earth in the metaverse, with thousands of specially chosen workers digging, building, farming, and generally keeping Mars livable for the supers. The virtual awards for this work were awesome, but of course, it didn't include a ticket to Mars. It was estimated that with the now 1,500 Mars habitats, around 20,000 people could go and live there for a period of at least 25 years. Something that looked promising was the once-trapped carbon dioxide beneath the planet's surface had been used to create a kind of blanket around the habitats. These places were also now more livable thanks to workers down on Earth using state-of-the-art machinery along with AI to release other trapped gases and raise the atmospheric temperatures around the places where the habitats were. Meanwhile, the regular elites, the many scientists, creative academics, and generally wealthy folks stayed behind to focus on trying to avoid the impending destruction. What they didn't know was that things on Earth were about to change in ways none of those so-called experts ever expected. 90 billion. The Earth started getting colder, faster than anyone could have known. At first, the scientists put it down to a mini ice age, something that had been expected to happen in the past, but never did. Those same experts started talking about the possibility of a rapid ice age. And when they said rapid, they meant it cooling down over maybe 100 to 200 years. Human emissions had always been thought to have deterred the next ice age, but things started changing when the Earth hit 90 billion in population. After the supers all went to Mars, a huge decision had been made to allow the workers in the metaverse to work on virtual renewable energy solutions. Remember, the workers were only button pushers. The rule was their actions should be inconsequential in the larger scheme of things. As the great Austrian philosopher Otfall Thaler once said, "The herd is beautiful only when the death of its parts go unnoticed." In short, they followed orders and never worked on the important tasks. To open up this other part of the metaverse was a last gasp at saving the Earth. Although no one ever thought that the workers had the brain capacity to be that inventive. Never underestimate a person who wants more points and more sex, is the apt saying here. After around a decade, the next generation nuclear fusion was invented by a woman from a lowly panopticon, first in virtual form but later put into practice by the elite scientists. In short, those atomic reactions that happen at the center of our glorious sun were harnessed and manipulated to create safe energy that left no toxic waste behind. This had been tried before and it had failed many times over, leading some to call it a pipe dream. It was now real, and it happened at a time when the Earth was naturally entering a cooler period. Then, when the technology in the metaverse was opened up to even more workers, soon a brilliant innovation led to the creation of endless solar fuel, whereby the sun's energy was used to create an endless supply of chemical fuel, free chemical fuel. No one owned the sun, after all. And then came the elite and worker rebellion that kicked off what someone called, in a groundbreaking research paper, "Humanity and Civilization Phase 2, Beginning." 100 billion. Against the wishes of the super elites now living a hard life on Mars, the entire metaverse was open to the billions of workers. Along with the world's natural cooling and fantastic energy innovations, the Earth was already looking like a better place to live. It was now safer to leave the containments, and for the first time in many years, the masses started to leave the panopticons in search of a new life, in search of love, in search of adventure. New societies were being built using the same advanced machinery that had been used on Mars. AI worked in tandem with human intellect. These societies were based not on constant economic growth, but on ongoing sustainability. The metaverse was turned from a form of slavery and distraction into a place of creativity and invention. Consumption, it was agreed, was not the meaning of life. Curiosity was, as was the quest for peace and happiness, which was a life's work that kept people trying to be the best version of themselves. They even started reading again. Sometimes philosophy of all things, with this line from Bertrand Russell, used as a slogan for the metaverse. "A happy life must be to a great extent a quiet life, for it is only in an atmosphere of quiet that true joy dare live." And they took heed of another thing Russell said. "Collective fear stimulates herd instinct and tends to produce ferocity toward those who are not regarded as members of the herd." As the Earth cooled and there was an abundant and safe fuel, people lived in these smaller self-governing societies. With these wise words in mind, they knew they had to work together to survive and never allow their most base animal instincts to be the driver of their societies as they had in the past. Each person lived and worked for the good of the community. As had once been predicted in the past, these pop-up societies appeared all over the world. And that is why they put up a new virtual no-entry sign to the super elite Mars dwellers, now sick from toxins and depressed in their cosmic squalor. The shuttles on Mars were purposefully made unusable, and so those supers who'd kept the workers in bondage for so long were left to their own devices. Cannibalism became a way of life up there. Turned out that 80% of the supers were psychopathic, and their isolation had made their cruelty even more extreme. 100 billion was doable, with the right amount of will and clever thinking. 100 billion was workable when at the forefront of all mankind's laws was love. The big question was, as humans developed new languages and cultures, were they going to make some of the same mistakes again? Now you need to watch a similar fiction. Why would it suck to live through the end of the universe?